Hey, this is your name, your name, your name. And, they say it ain't easy. Ian Green.
Gangrene.
The New York Jets
have their man.
Jets got themselves a great Robert Saleh.
Robert Saleh.
Talk about all gas, no break.
The great one.
We're not talking about effort on the field. We're talking about the process at which we do things.
Oh, I'm not going to lie to you.
Hurry up, hurry up, hurry up. Keep your foot on the pedal. Base, 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 base.
There's no way I'm not going to have enthusiasm on the sideline.
Hey, own this rep. Own this rep.
The New York Jets.
We can beat anybody in the world, and I think we're going to win next Sunday.
Welcome to the latest edition of the Ain't Easy Being Green podcast, broadcasting to you live from beautiful, amazing, picturesque Crystal Lake Studios in Putnam Valley, New York. My name is Keith Farrell. I am joined, as always, by my colleague and co-host, the number one Jet fan in the state of Texas, Michael Legarris, everyone.
Yo!
Guys, don't worry. The Wookiee's still going to be back here. He'll be back from time to time. We haven't lost the Wookiee. We have a new venture in the future coming up that Wookiee's going to be a part of. But we do have someone else joining the team, Mike. We do have someone else joining the team. Got a trial run the past 2 weeks. Guess what he did? He hit it out of the park, Mike. Hit it out of the park. We can get into that in a moment. Harrison's a champion, teacher, podcaster, writer, the busiest man in the Jet universe today. Welcome to the show, Harrison Glazer.
I appreciate it, man. I'm excited. Like, you guys run a great show here. The Ain't Easy Being Green podcast is elite, man. You guys light it up every week. I'm excited to be joining the team. I'm excited to be here, bring, you know, my perspective, my voice, my ideas. This is going to be good stuff, man. I can't wait to get into it and talk all about them Jets because there's a lot to talk about.
Well, yeah. The biggest thing is you're a Jet fan.
I'm a Jet fan. Through and through, man. Through and through.
He's a Jet fan. We are united in brotherhood. We are Jet fans. So let's get it.
Yeah, being a Jet fan is like a badge of honor. Like you said, there's no fair weather Jet fan. There was a fair weather Jet fan. They left in like 1970, like 1971. Yeah. That's when the fair weather Jet fans were.
No, and I'm just being real. Let me be real with you. Like, I see a Jet fan in Houston walking around with a Jet shirt. I'm like, oh, that dude's from New York. Like, I know. Like, it's not fake. You could be a Yankee fan walking around. You could be, you know, bandwagon, whatever. You're a Jet fan. You know what I'm saying? You're real. Yeah. You're real. It's just the way it is.
Like, and there's no bandwagon to jump on. So there's your exactly. Fan, your fandom. There's certain teams. Your fandom is never questioned when someone sees you rocking it. You see the Yanks. You see the Giants. You see the Steelers. You see the Cowboys. Certain
right.
Teams. Like, all right, it could be. There's a chance it's Fugazi. There's a chance it's Fugazi. Nobody sees somebody wearing Jet gear and goes, oh, that guy jumped on the bandwagon. Everyone goes, that dude's a real fan right there. And Harrison's one of those people joining us on the permanent basis here now, so we're stoked about that. And let's just get right to it, guys. Last week, Union City, New Jersey, Bergen Field, Manhattan, Brooklyn, Bronx. You guys lit it up. I mean, we had our most listens ever. Keith, Mike, the Harrison combination. I mean, we hit it out of the park last week, Mike. We just got to thank everybody. I mean, we got to. I don't know what the flood of interest was last week. Harrison was a big part of it. The show was tremendous. So I want to thank everyone for jumping on board with us last week. Our biggest week ever, Mike. Most successful week in the history of AEBG when it comes to listens, downloads, all those things. We start switching it over to YouTube. Maybe some people start clicking on the videos, get a few more views, get a few more subscribers. Who knows what could happen, Mike? Who knows what could happen?
Who knows?
But if you guys don't mind, I'm just going to take 2 seconds here just to give my little cousin a shout out. Liam Farrell. My little cousin, kudos to you. He's heading into his senior year of high school coming up here. He plays on a travel team for a while now, soccer travel team that's been going around the country kicking butt. They play all over the place. These kids are really, really good. They've won the state title, the state cup, 3 years in a row. They were going for that fourth year in a row this past weekend. Okay, guys, the game was 1-0. Their team was winning. Got tied up 1-1. Got to the 70th minute. Crunch time. Crucial moments of the game. And this happens right here. Nice little set piece. See a little set piece. Nice pass and Boyaka! Top right corner, getting the job done. I see you, Liam. Knocking that goal in to win the game. Ended up being the game winner. Let's just watch it one more time. Let's throw it up here again. Oh! Skill, the patience, the anticipation. It's all there. The kids got it all. Big in the most crucial moments of the game. Liam Farrell, kudos to you. 4 titles in a row for your squadron. Kudos to you guys. Number 10, number 12, number 14. Guys played great. Everyone played great. The whole team played good. Number 20, little number 20 out there causing problems for people. I saw what you were up to. I saw you miss the ball on purpose there when the ref bounced at you. Probably took another minute off the clock on that sideline throw. Number 20, smart guy. But my favorite part of the game was the goal, obviously, but it was after the goal, guys. Okay? Because during the game, a bunch of these little chumps who were rooting for the other team, because this happened to be an away game, were screaming a bunch of things, obscenities, things that were offensive. But when you're 17 or 18, like these clowns, being offensive is funny then. That's funny then. You're going to grow up and realize how stupid you are. But you don't know that now, so I'll give you a pass, you little chumps. It's cool. But you're yelling out a bunch of things, stupid things, immature things. And then the goal gets dropped on your boys, and this happens. That's right. You got shushed, and you got your comeuppance. There it is right there. So once again, very proud of you, Liam. Very proud of your team. You guys did a great job. Kudos to winning 4 titles in a row. And always remember, in life, you'll learn this. Those guys on the field talking all that smack, number 8 in the other team pushing people. Then when the ref gets in front of him, he's calling people a pussy. You're going to learn that's the softest guy on the other team. He's trying to present himself as the opposite of that because he's standing in front of his friends. He wants to be an idiot. He's calling this guy this. He's calling that guy a name. He's pushing people. Once the ref gets there, he gets even louder. That's the softest guy on their team. So that's my cousin knocking the game-winning goal in the State Cup Finals.
Woo!
In Connecticut, getting the job done, okay? Showing the athletic prowess of the Farrells has been passed on to the next generation, all right? Game-winning goal. State championship game, that's a big deal. I want to ask you guys. Now, I don't have anything equivalent to that personally myself, okay? You know, you killed it there, okay? I can't equal that in my life. And you're only like 16, 17 years old. So, you know, that's kudos to you. But let me ask Michael. I'm going to go to you first. In your own personal life. Now, not everyone has to achieve that level of greatness. It could just be beating someone you hate one-on-one. We all have those things that in our life we remember as our best sports moment individually. If you participated in sports, Mike, what's yours?
Oh, man. My top sports moment probably was when me, my boy Vernon, and my boy Dave at high school did a 3-on-3 tournament, and we just smoked everybody in the building.
Dominated.
You
just dominated in the low crush block, cats. Mike, like this? Calling for it?
Just crushed cats. it was ill. And it was you know, the varsity basketball team. We were younger, too.
Yeah.
Just smoked everybody. That was awesome. I mean, I played varsity basketball, had a good few moments there.
Yeah.
Had a couple of dunks in games. That was pretty dope.
Nice.
But that, like, winning it and then looking at everybody in my school like,
what's up now?
Greatest.
Oh, I love it. That's a dope one right there. Harrison, what do you got for us in your life, your best athletic achievement, or just your best sports moment in your own life?
And that's an easy one for me. I mean, it's not football. I mean, ironically, even though as much as I love football, I wrote an article about it last year when I was telling my story. I actually, interestingly enough, and it could be one of my stories, I actually walked on to Stony Brook's team. And I actually went from not playing sports, you know, at all. Like, I wasn't playing football. I played in my freshman year. I was kind of like, I was a big guy, but I wasn't the strongest. I was playing line, but I wasn't the best at it. Like, I remember like playing offensive line and not being able to get the assignments right.
Yeah.
And not knowing, like, those guys are so smart. They don't get enough credit. Like, they really don't. Like, the backbone of teams. And I remember the coach just turning me around, like literally coming out in the field and just turning me around and go, okay, your job is to now get to the quarterback because that'll be easier, hopefully, for you. But
oh, that's awesome, man.
Yeah. But moving on from that, though, my favorite baseball memory is actually from baseball. Like, I remember I played travel baseball when I was younger, and we were in the championships, we were in the playoffs, and it was like the perfect situation. Like, I wasn't as good as football, but baseball was my sport. Like, I was a power hitter. I always batted cleanup. That was my position. Literally couldn't be more perfect. We're in like the bottom of the final inning, and we're down by one run. There's a guy on third. We have one out. I'm up to bat. I just knock it, not too hard, but just enough that it goes over the infield, but yeah, in front of the outfield, because that's all I had to do. Exactly. Yeah. I get to first. I just remember getting to first and turning around, and everyone is charging at me, and all of a sudden I'm being lifted up, and they're going, Harrison, Harrison. And then the coach gives me the game ball and tells me I earned it. Like, that was without a doubt my greatest sports
ball. Oh, that's
sick.
Awesome.
Oh, I never.
You can't. And those are the type of things, man, that just stay with you for your whole life. game-winning hits, game-winning moments. My cousin's going to be 40 one day. Maybe he'll go on and have a great career in soccer. But that moment he had last weekend is going to probably last with him. Guys, me personally, I don't have anything that can equal to your playing at Stony Brook Harrison or a legendary hit in a competitive game. I've had a few. Nothing where my team mobbed me. I wish that happened. But I do have this, guys. I do have this. Michael Garris knows me and all of our friends used to play this pickup softball game every weekend for about 6 or 7 years. Oh. And in the World Series, the Willow World Series, guys, 3-game series, game 3, bottom of the 7, bases loaded. Chris Schleich, I cannot wait for you to hear this podcast right now. You served one up, full count, and I put it in the water to hit a grand slam to win the World Series. Okay, Harrison, I got mobbed by my friends, got beers dumped on my head as a 21-year-old man, and nothing is better than defeating your friends. Nothing in the world, maybe besides the Jets winning a Super Bowl, okay? Second to that is beating my friends at anything, and they all know that. Okay, so, hey, look, my cousin's got a great achievement. Harrison's got a great one. Me and Mike, you know, we got ours too, but that's why we love sports, guys, moments like that. And we're hoping, and with the Jets here, we're hoping 2021, we're going to get some of these moments with one Zach Wilson.
Yeah.
We're not, guys.
Guys,
and OTAs has popped off, and I'm going to let Mike just take it because Mike has been loving him. Harrison's been tweeting out about him left and right. Go ahead, Mike.
Look. And again, I don't want to go beat a dead horse. 2018, I didn't want Sam Darnold. I wanted Baker Mayfield. We didn't get Baker Mayfield. We got Sam, whatever. This year, I wanted Zach Wilson. Keith knows it. Everyone, I wanted him. That's who I want. I didn't want Trevor Lawrence. I want Zach Wilson. He comes in. He doesn't look like a rookie. He's executing. His numbers as of today in OTAs, 83 for 108. This is by Mr. Matt O'Leary. Thank you for the stats. 83 for 108, 76% completion percentage. I understand it's OTAs. He's completing 76% of his passes. 13 touchdowns, one int, and that int wasn't his fault, and which Harrison will talk about here in a second. Yesterday was his best day. He was decimating. Keith, killing it.
Was.
I'm not playing. Like, he was lighting up the defense, okay?
The exact quote, actually, which was beautiful, was Zach Wilson doesn't look good for a rookie. He just looks good.
Yes.
Period.
Yes.
He was connecting with Elijah Moore multiple occasions. He was connecting with Keelan Cole. Grab that you tweeted out, Harrison. I had to rewind it a couple times and said, what the
heck? It's exciting.
Whoa. Nice. Okay. Now, again, let's not get all our panties in a bunch. Let's not get all ridiculous. But what I am saying is this. The fact that, he plays at BYU. He plays against bad competition. He's playing in the NFL right now. Lighting it up in camp. So, next step. Let's see with the pads. And then absolutely the game. But so far, you cannot be not excited as a New York Jet fan. Harrison, please take it away.
Yeah, man, and you nailed it, you know, with all those things. I did this. I disproved all of them. When all those stupid rumors came out, I disproved them immediately. The ones with them saying, you know, the 3-car garage, crapping, entitled, not a team player, not a leader. Well, he wasn't a cap. He had a captain badge on every color uniform. Like, I literally tweeted that. I thought every color uniform, all 4 that he wore, each one had a captain badge. He was a leader. All of his teammates came out, immediately refuted all those things. I'm with you, and I think you and me saw it eye to eye, going back to, like you said, 2018. I wasn't on the Sam train either, and primarily because I didn't think we were going to get him. Like, it was projected that we weren't getting him. I was originally, actually, Lamar Jackson was my guy. Like, Lamar Jackson was totally my guy. Loved him. Big ACC fan. Watched him a lot. Same reason I was big on Mekhi Becton. But I knew there was no way we were taking him at 3. Like, I just knew that wasn't happening. Like, I wanted Lamar Jackson, but I'm like, that's not happening. So I got all aboard the Baker train. Like, I was all aboard.
I was all on Baker.
I was ready. I was reading articles of his character and his leadership and everything. And I was like, this guy's going to be freaking great. I'm ready. I was the stupidest thing. I was running around saying stupid shit like, bake me a cake. I was running like, bake me a cake. Baker's our guy. Like, stupid things. Like, I was all excited. I was hyped.
I know. With a flag. I sent pictures of him just putting the flag into Gillette Stadium. I remember, son. I was telling Keith. And then
you want that in New York. Like, you want those giant cojones.
Then those stories started coming out that the Browns wanted Baker. I'm like, what? No. And then I was right there at the draft, and they took him, and I just looked to the ground.
Yeah, I was disappointed.
Man.
Yeah. And like, it was shocking. It shocked everybody.
Yeah, we weren't in contact with you at that point, Harrison, but me and Mike that night were not the most excited. Now, what you do as fans, what do? You draft a guy you're not excited about, you regroup eventually, and you say, all right, let's get behind him and hope Sam could kill it. But the initial feelings and initial trepidation I think you had, Mike had, I had, many Jet fans had, proved, at least with the Jets here, to be correct with Sam. He's not somebody that's going to carry the team on his back. He's not going to do it himself. And you hopefully don't have to put Zach Wilson into that situation. But this kid, I mean, this kid, when it comes to just in shorts, like you guys said, he's slinging it. Looks efficient, getting rid of the ball quick. A big throw to Elijah Moore yesterday. You guys know Elijah Moore made the one-handed grab touchdown. Keelan Cole killing it. But let's get into one Elijah Moore. First glance, OTAs, first reps, first time out there. What are people saying about one Elijah Moore?
It could not be going better. It literally couldn't be going any better. I mean, I was excited when we got him. I remember he wasn't on my radar. I was thinking we'd go wide receiver later. But he's the kind of guy, when you take him, you're like, oh, okay, cool. Like, you guys remember, I pointed out, we talked about it. Elijah Moore had the most receiving yards in the slot in the last 2 years, period. Caught every single one of his red zone targets, 25 or 25. Elite route runner, which is kind of like what we were talking about before with the, which I was actually going to bring up with Keelan Cole. We can, transition with that as well. But it's interesting. You mentioned, you know, Keelan Cole and what's going on with the starters right there. What's interesting is, and I was surprised by it because, you know, Mims is our guy. Like, I really liked Mims. Like, Mims was supposed to be a first-round prospect. I mean, I still think he's super talented. I've even said I still think he can be a wide receiver one. Like, you watch some of the catches he makes, some of the ability he has. I think he totally has it, and he can be that. But so far in camp, and you look at I mentioned before, I was talking to you guys earlier about, I've actually been in contact with one of the beat writers. I'm doing exclusives now on my Twitter where we're doing personal interviews. He said it, and then also Connor Hughes confirmed it. He's actually asked a question, and Hughes tweeted me back. Hughes tweeted and answered back, and I put an article out today saying this, that apparently we all thought Mims wasn't playing because he was injured, which was the conception. Right. But apparently, according to Connor Hughes and DJ, again, both confirmed it, both saying verbatim the same thing, which is when I was like, okay, that's interesting. That Mims has been healthy for a couple of days now, but he's consistently been working with the twos. Yeah. And Keelan Cole has been consistently working with the ones. And it's not just a fluke. Hughes went as far to say, and I didn't know this was news to me, like breaking news. Apparently he said Joe Douglas has been trying to acquire Keelan Cole for the last 2 years, hasn't been able to because the Jaguars didn't want to let him go. They knew what they had. And if you think about it, Joe Douglas has only been here 2 years. So basically, as long as he's been here, he's been trying to get Keelan Cole. So when and what they also pointed out was, in this new scheme, in the Robert Saleh scheme that they're in, the Mike LaFleur system that they're using, you want precision route runners. That's a very important aspect, they were saying. And they feel, from what they've seen, that Mims is a very linear player and kind of more one-dimensional. Which, again, I kind of disagree with. I like what I saw in Mims. I feel like that root tree can develop. But from what they're saying and what they're seeing, Keelan Cole is consistently running with the ones. Even though Mims is healthy right now, they like his running ability. And even though they drafted Mims last year, because my thought would be, you know, he's one of Douglas's guys. He just took Mims. Well, at the same time, they just said he's been trying to actively get Keelan Cole, which means Keelan Cole is also one of his guys.
Yeah.
So it's very interesting to watch that situation to see, once they put pads on, how that develops.
Look. Yeah, and you know what, dude? When you started tweeting out about that, not to interrupt you, Mike, I looked into that, and that's all I read, was that it seems like, at least thus far, they think Cole's a better fit for what they're trying to do on offense. And that's the word I heard used with Mims, was linear, with these straight routes, with maybe not
that's
having...
exactly what I heard.
When it comes to his routes, we know Elijah Moore is not going to have an issue with that, or some of the other guys, but I don't know, Mike, do you think with us having Davis, Elijah Moore, I think they might work something out with Crowder's contract here. He might be on this team next year when we start. And now Keelan Cole's ascension, where does that kind of put Mims here in the pecking order?
I think that Keelan Cole, right from the get, had a rapport with Zach Wilson. Zach Wilson, immediately on his first OTAs, you guys remember, him and Keelan Cole just had a connection. I read it on multiple beat writers that were covering it. And look, when you have that type of connection that's organic, you don't mess with it. And look, the offense will become what it is. We're not going to force feed anything. Denzel Mims has a skill set. There's no question about that. But he's going to have to make his presence known and put himself in this offense where he becomes a value. But I will tell you this, I'm seeing, and hearing about Braxton Berrios making impacts in this offense. See, it's all about scheme. See, people talk about, oh, it's the quarterback. Oh, it's a talent is important because you got to be able to execute. But the scheme is really what allows a player to blossom. And this scheme fit could be amazing for people like Braxton Berrios and for Keelan Cole and for Corey Davis, who is a spectacular route runner. Remember what we were saying? That's what this is all about. Blocking, running scheme, and being able to get open when you're supposed to. And I'm telling you this, if Mims falls behind a bit, okay. But I'm sure that Mike LaFleur is going to use him as the wet, because I'll tell you this, he has the same speed that an Elijah Moore and that a Keelan Cole have. He's a very fast receiver, and none of them have the length he has. So there will be opportunity for him on third and four, third and two near the goal line to throw, you know what I'm saying? Where he's got certain tools that the others physically just don't. So we'll see where everything falls, but a smart offensive coordinator, a smart coach will leverage their tools, their people, their players correctly.
Yeah, you know what? I think when you're talking about Corey Davis, guys, we know he's in line for a big target share next year. And I think Elijah Moore, I mean, just getting back to him real quick, when you talk about routes, being athletic, fast, smart, there's nothing, that kid doesn't really have a weak spot in his game. And what the reports you're reading is he's not dropping anything, which isn't a surprise. I think it was 98% of catchable balls last year he caught, which is just blows your mind, 84% altogether. And he had 86 catches. He only played 8 games. So it's not like a guy who you look out there like Waddle and you're like, oh, he had 45 catches. This guy had a ton of targets, caught everything around him. So, and he ran a 4.35. So I don't know where Mims, when this shakes out, I mean, Harrison's going to be on the inside beat for us here, but when this shakes out, man, I'm very interested to see where Mims falls in the pecking order. I really, really am interested to see where that falls, man.
Yeah, no, I agree, man. And kind of like what Mike pointed out, you know, with where Mims could potentially fall, I think like Mike said, he'll definitely be utilized in certain situations because that's what Robert Saleh does. We talked about, and Michael Floor scheming intelligently, not being the Adam Gase of trying to force a round piece into a square hole for like 35 minutes and forcing it. He's going to use players to their strengths. So Mims will be used. The question is Mims going to get a lot of time over Keelan Cole? Would be interesting.
Now I'm going to say something that's controversial because Keith is going to fight this, but I have to bring it up. Chris Herndon has been doing a pretty good job in camp, huh, Harris?
Yes, he has. No, Herndon's been really good. What surprises me.
Yeah, and not just that. Zach likes him a lot from what I've been reading. And he has been catching the ball and he has not been dropping it. And he's been consistently one of the top receivers in OTAs, Keith.
Is that right?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, Herndon's been good. I mean, I was hoping Kenny Yeboah would step up as a receiving option. I haven't heard anything from him. In fact, I've actually heard more receiving from Tyler Croft, which is very interesting. I would actually say Tyler Croft has gotten probably as much attention as Chris Herndon has. Honestly, they've both been decent receiving options. So if you want a wild take, my wild take is if Tyler Croft looks as good as Chris Herndon, well, Tyler Croft can block circles around Chris Herndon.
That's true.
Now, I'd like to see Tyler Croft play more if they both look equal.
I mean, Chris Herndon was supposed to be a receiving tight end who just couldn't catch the ball last year, as we know. His second year, he gets a DUI, blows his hamstring out, wasted that whole season. And his first year, he had a couple of good games, don't get me wrong. People act like he was like a great tight end. He wasn't. He wasn't great that year either. So this is year four. And like we said, I'm happy that Wilson and Moore and other guys are doing good in OTAs. And it matters that Herndon is doing good too, Mike, because when's the last positive report on this kid we've heard? It's been a while. Okay, so I'll accept it. I'll file it away. And we'll see what happens once these preseason games starts coming, because he has been an absolute dumpster fire of a tight end for 2 years. You can't block and you can't catch. Why are you on the football team? What do you do for the football team to help us? You do nothing. Okay, I don't even want to talk about Chris Herndon. He just makes me mad. But what I do want to go through, and I want to throw this at Harrison, is last year's draft class, okay? Bunch of dudes, bunch of good players. Some guys play decent. We know Beckton, we know Mims flashed. Davis was not the best, but he showed some flashes here and there. I want to get into the last year's draft class so far in 2021. I know it hasn't been a lot of time.
It's panned out exactly how I thought it would. It is. And if you guys want to check it out, I've been saying for a long time, since the first draft, the end of the first draft, I've been saying Joe Douglas is a great GM. Yeah. And everyone's like, what are you talking about? Like, he just had his first draft. You haven't seen anything pan out. I'm like, trust me. From everything I've seen, from the situation he was put in, from decisions he made, I was getting to that point. Like, this guy just, he does everything right. Like, he checks everything. I was at the point by the draft where I was like, if he kills it, He's a great GM. So yeah. On Monday, actually, because people ask me all the time, I put out a podcast. Check it out. My last podcast episode on my Take Flight Spit and Fire podcast. It was an hour and change of me going through all the reasons of why I think Joe Douglas is a great GM. From the impossible position he was put in to the decisions he's made across the board.
Let me ask you this, though. So 2020 draft. Now, and so far as today, as we do this podcast update, Becton, another injury. I'm not saying he's injury prone, but in the NFL, he's had a few here.
He's not injury prone.
I know in Louisville, he didn't get hurt a lot, but I don't give a shit about Louisville. I care about the Jets. On the Jets, he's been hurt more than I want, okay? I don't care if he didn't college. It means nothing to me. Let me just go through this real quick. Becton's been hurt. Mims been doing nothing so far. And he dropped a couple balls yesterday. Davis, I don't think he's on the field yet, right? Ashton Davis still has a nagging injury. I don't think he's out there yet. Morgan, it looks like he doesn't even know how to play football.
Morgan should
get cut. Quarterback. So Zuniga and Clark are running with the backups, and then Hall and Perine are also question marks. So that's what I'm saying. I
wouldn't call Hall a question mark. Hall's penciled in as CB1 right now.
Yeah, he is CB1.
Like, that's CB1? Yeah, without a doubt. Well, and it's honestly, it's kind of like,
I guess Brian Costello, New York Post, would disagree with you because he put him on. But he said he's the question mark, Perine's question mark. Everyone from the draft class last year, apparently, so far has done nothing in OTAs at all. So that's what I'm trying to get to here is, like, should we be concerned about this? Because you need that class to hit. You need a bunch of those guys to hit. I'm not hearing anything about any of those guys right now.
So right now the CB1 is Hall. I don't – Costello is one of the worst. I can't take that guy. I don't listen to him at all. He's useless.
Yeah, my guy's using DJ.
Hall is CB1 right now. Whether is he going to be a great cornerback? I don't know. I'm not saying he is, but he's the number one cornerback.
We got no one else.
That's what it is. Ashton Davis, we're going to go through positional groups. I'm excited about him, but again, he hasn't really proven anything. Morgan was a terrible pick. He should be cut. He shouldn't even be on the team, period.
Well, I can get wanting to cut him now, but I actually don't think he was a terrible pick.
I understand what they did. He just isn't good. I mean, Harrison, he's not good.
No, I'm not arguing that. I'm just saying that it was a bad pick at the time, I disagree with.
Right.
But
right.
Cutting him now, I can totally be on board.
Understood. But you never know what you're going to get from a quarterback in the fourth round, right? You never know. I mean, look at what we did in the second round with Christian Hackenberg. I mean, that was the second round. That was the worst pick ever.
You guys know what I don't know if you guys told you.
Yeah, yeah.
But Dak Prescott.
Zuniga. Again, question mark. P. Ryan, I don't really think he has a spot on.
But
this
I think
team.
You. Can
I don't say, either. But Hall, Robert Saleh proved me wrong about P. Ryan.
Bryce Hall's played 9 games though, so if someone wants to say he's a question mark, that's not a stretch. I don't care if he's penciling a CB1 or not. He's played 9 games as a pro in the NFL, but that doesn't mean he's a CB1.
Well, if you're questioning, can he get injured again? That's possible because he had injury history in college. That's why he was such a late pick.
And when Bryce Hall played,
when he played, he looked like a first round pick. Like, people said that.
When we say question mark, right, Mr. Costello puts a question mark. The CB1 was taken in the fifth round. That's a phenomenal pick in the fifth round.
I think he got another one in the sixth.
It's not a question mark. It's a hit. Period. I don't want anyone
saying
that that's a bad pick.
Like, yeah, but hold on a second. I get what you're trying to say, but if Bryce Hall's our CB1 by default, he's played 9 games. And I understand people thought he played great last year. That's fine. But what is he ranked in the NFL cornerback?
No,
as
a pick for Joe Douglas, it's an A+.
As a fifth round pick, without a doubt.
But I know, but that's not even in the conversation. What does that have to do with that?
But we're judging Joe Douglas's drafting. Right?
I'm judging the CB1. I don't care if he's the first pick of the draft.
Well, we
or
don't
the seventh
know.
Round.
And that's what I'm saying.
Who
we
cares?
Don't know. We don't.
Don't
know.
Sleep on Bryce Hall.
No. We don't know if Bryce Hall is going to be a great corner. I said that. We don't know if Bryce Hall is
going to
be a
great corner. That's why he's a question mark. That's all he was saying, I think. I don't. My point is, all I'm saying is this, and you guys can disagree. I don't know anyone from last year's draft except Becton right now that I'm confident in saying, they're going to be good moving forward as a Jet for the next 3 or 4
years. Well, before, I'm happy to answer, because before, you mentioned it, and you said, you want me to defend that class? I'll defend it. Man, it was a great draft then, and it's still a great draft. I mean, you look at OTAs, again, it's shorts right now, so this doesn't mean anything. And you mentioned some guys, it's voluntary. Some guys aren't even there, and some guys are banged up right now, taking it easy. Like, that's the thing with Becton. Last year, he's not injury prone. Last year, he had a shoulder injury. And this is very important. I've been saying this a lot. I tweeted this out last year and pointed it out. When it was happening, I was screaming it on top of my lungs because I actually had spoken to somebody in the medical staff. They're not there anymore, which is probably a good thing, maybe, but in the medical staff at the time that I wound up meeting when I was back in 2018. And what they had told me was, and I, based on Becton's injury, and I'd looked it up myself and done research, and they confirmed this for me, his shoulder injury, you can't play through that. If you're an offensive lineman that uses your upper body and your arms for leverage, you can't play through that. In fact, they confirmed for me, because I looked it up, his injury, if continued to be aggravated, would eventually and inevitably lead to a tear. And that's what I was saying last year, that he needed to be shut down, and Adam Gase was forcing him back out. See, he's not injury prone. He never had time to heal. The guy's thrown back out before he's ready because the guy wants to play. He was a rookie. Of course the kid wants to play. We saw guys back in the 90s and 80s, remember, like, their head is falling off and they're walking out on the field. It's the coach's job as the freaking adult and the medical staff to say no, but Adam Gase didn't do that. Same thing with Sam Darnold. Sam Darnold had a separated AC joint last year, which is the same thing as a separated shoulder, yet they kept playing him.
Yeah.
Like, it's crazy.
And I Mims, forgot about that Mims, with Becton and Gase.
And when Mims got time, Mims was in the top 10 in yards per catch.
I can't wait to I'll defend
he was in top 10 in yards per catch. So he didn't do anything special, to your point, but let's see what he does.
He looks special.
We just got to finish talking about how he might be like fifth on the depth chart. So I mean,
maybe,
I get it.
You don't know. It is a question mark to your
Mekhi point. Becton has plantar fasciitis right now. People that are 110 pounds get plantar fasciitis.
Right.
It has nothing to do with weight, nothing to do with size. They asked Robert Saleh, and again, it's maybe some people say it's Rich Samini. I don't know who it is, but sometimes I guess somebody twists the story. Because Robert Saleh, people said that he was saying, oh, Mekhi's weight's a problem. That's not what he said. I listened to the interview. He said, if the guy is athletic and agile in this system, he's fine the way he is, and actually shook his head and then went to say conditioning is king. And some people just focused on the conditioning part. Mekhi Becton is faster and more quick at 370 pounds than guys that are 300 pounds, 290 pounds. Is fast. He's quick.
But how are you defending P. Ryan? I thought that was a terrible. I didn't like the pick when they made it. I don't like that pick, and I think he should be cut, in my opinion.
So here's the mic. Yeah.
And how do you support Zuniga? Because there were other players on the
board.
He's
almost like incomplete.
It's funny you're saying that.
I haven't seen him yet, you know, because the kid's been banged up so much.
I don't like those two. And Cameron Clark better be a left guard. Like, we heard all this stuff about Cameron Clark. He's one of the guys.
I like him.
I'm like this. To this year, you better show up, bro.
Well, here's the beauty. Okay, if you want something quick, and this is, so I mentioned before, I'm actually doing exclusive interviews now. I'm talking personally with DJ, one of the beat writers. Yeah. He actually mentioned that to me because we brought up Cameron Clark, and this is interesting. I didn't realize this. He said it's very difficult to get a beat on who the starting offensive linemen are in OTAs, because he said they're constantly rotating and shifting, and the way they line up with shorts is not the same. So he said it's almost impossible to get a real beat on who the starters are. Okay. So that's an interesting thing. He said until they put pads on, he said, on offensive line, you can't really know for sure. And that's really kind of a direct quote from him.
Guys, can I do a quick pivot? I want to ask you guys this. What do you think about Morgan Moses and all the buzz you're hearing about?
That'd be a hell of a pickup, man.
That's a no-brainer, right?
No-brainer, yeah. I mean, if you sign him, George Fant. I mean, if he doesn't want to play right guard, it's how fast can you walk out the door? Like, Morgan Moses is amazing, man. Morgan Moses has been one of the top right guards in the NFL for 10 years. Oh, and on top of that, he had his best career year last year. Oh, I want him, man. I don't get why he's not in the building yet. Joe Douglas and me seem to see the same on offensive line with Mekhi Becton, with AVT. I'm surprised Morgan Moses isn't in the building right now.
That's another big monster, too. That's a big man.
Exactly. Well. No, exactly. And that's the thing with Cameron Clark. You mentioned I liked him a lot. I said it last year when they drafted him. You're just going through last year's draft class. Offensive linemen take time to develop. That's why these ready-to-go offensive linemen go high. AVT, Becton, they go quick because most offensive linemen aren't ready. The caliber of a defensive edge rusher in the NFL versus college is like it's not even measurable. Like, it's on a different wavelength.
Yeah.
Like, for these offensive linemen to transition to covering a J.J. Watt or his brother or the Boses, it's different.
Yeah.
So you don't want to force an offensive lineman that's not ready out too quick. So that's why offensive lineman, I feel, is one of those few positions still that takes time to develop. Right. I'd said by this year, I think he'd be starting. Bro, Joe Douglas told Cameron Clark, I'm drafting you for your nasty streak. This dude likes to put people down. He plays nasty. He plays with a chip on his shoulder. He takes it personal. He finishes dudes. Like, in a way, he's like a smaller Mekhi. Like, don't sleep on Cameron Clark.
And I know I shouldn't say this, Keith, but this year's draft – I'm good with Douglas, period. What I see in OTAs, yeah, I don't even need to see that. I'm good.
Yeah, guys, like, you know this. What I'm not even that down on last year's draft either. Just someone's got to play devil's advocate. We got to hold their feet to the fire and examine every little tidbit here. And when it comes to I want to ask you this too, Harrison and Mike. When it comes to Moses, say we did bring him in, is Font an upgraded guard over Van Roten?
I don't think Font's going to play. I think Font is more going to be a rotator.
Because when we signed him, remember, he had that flexibility that said he could play guard, tackle, all that.
Well, Font's contract is huge. I don't know if I keep
$8 million. Yeah. $8 million.
Font, and it became guaranteed after, I think, in March. But I think they're just going to use with the plantar fasciitis. I know that, Harrison, you're not as concerned, and I'm very concerned. Okay, because I saw Eli Manning. I saw many players in the NFL go through this, and you don't just get over it. It stays with you. And I don't know if Becton is going to be 100%. And if he's not 100%, I know he's planetary. I know he has gravity. Okay, but if he's not 100%, you know, that could be a risk. And we got young Zachary back there. Zach looks great in OTAs. What happens when he gets hit? I am concerned about it. And so I want Moses in there. And having a guy like Fant maybe be the insurance policy is exactly what would be needed, in my opinion, right now with this situation.
And that's logical, Mike, because, I mean, you look at the best quarterbacks in the league. You take Patrick Mahomes. What happened in the Super Bowl when the offensive line couldn't protect him? He's the best player in the league. I mean, you just need that protection. An average quarterback becomes great when he has protection.
Exactly.
And the great quarterbacks operate at levels you can't even imagine, like Tom Brady, when they have protection, right?
Dak Prescott, fourth-round pick, steps into the Cowboys and looked like a superstar. Why? Was it because of him, or was it because of that offensive line? Great quarterback, and he did develop into a really good one, but that offensive line definitely led.
That's my guy right there. I wish someone listened to me when it comes to quarterbacks. I can go off the list. Like, don't want to pat myself on the back too much. But my quarterbacks, if I would have got anything I wanted, we'd be fine right now. But I'm happy with Zach.
Yeah,
guys, one other guy I want to touch on now. He wasn't in camp for most of the OTAs. He was there. He's been there the last couple of days. Hasn't really participated too much yet. Carl Lawson. Harrison has some stats he wants us to throw.
Forget OTAs. That guy's going to be an animal.
I don't care about it. He could skip OTAs for all I care. Him and Quinn. Me and Harrison were texting before the show just thinking about him and Quinn. And I know Oldbrook just is foaming at the mouth thinking about this. Quinn and Williams.
And don't sleep on John Franklin Myers.
Yeah.
Oh, not at all. And this is the thing. There's other players that are going to benefit so much. Obviously, Quinnen Williams by himself is a tremendous player. But who else did teams have to focus on really last year when it came to getting after the quarterback? Really nobody. Now you can't just leave Lawson by himself. You have to do something. You have to have a running back keeping an eye. You have to have a tight end keeping an eye on him. And when it comes to ESPN Next Gen stats, now Harrison has some dope stats for us on Lawson. I want to throw this at you guys. Last year, sacks created in the NFL from ESPN Next Gen sacks, Lawson was seventh in the NFL, seventh most disruptive player in the league, up there with Aaron Donald, Myles Garrett, TJ Watt, Mac, Justin Houston, three-year, $45 million contract guys. I cannot wait to see this guy unleashed. It's been John Abraham probably the last time, I guess Calvin Page, we can technically count. John Abraham is a Calvin Page was not at this level. John Abraham was a high-end rusher of the quarterback, right? That's the last guy we've had of this, at least potential. Hasn't been there for OTAs. I didn't really care. Skip the OTAs. Send the videos in. He's there now. That's all that matters. What do you guys think about the potential of him and Q next season?
Let me ask you something. The last time we had a real, besides Abraham, a true, true pass rushing attack was the sack exchange, right?
I mean, Abraham and Ellis were on the team at the same time. I would say they generated
Ellis. That was exciting. Sean Ellis is one of my favorite pass rushers.
Sean Ellis,
without a question.
I would say, Mike, when it comes to the entire defensive line creating havoc, the 80s. But I think Abraham and Ellis caused some problems for people because Ellis, underrated player. And if you remember the game when we beat the Patriots up there, man, I mean, God bless Sean Ellis, sacking Tom Brady right there in the first drive. I love that, man. It's been forever, Mike. I mean, we have been asking, hoping, praying to sign a guy, draft a guy, get a guy off the edge that could cause problems. And I heard a lot of Jet fans, I shouldn't say a lot, but maybe guys that aren't in the know as much as Harrison or people like us that just devour all this information. They're like, well, look at all the ceiling. They had that many sacks last year. And I get it. I know that sack total. You want to see a guy rip off 15, 20 sacks, whatever. But that's not what it's all about.
I'll make you feel better about it.
Yeah, go ahead, Harrison. Let them know. Let them know.
I'll make you feel better about it.
I would just want to say, I just want to give one of my predictions real quick and then let go. I think this will be the best defensive line the Jets have had since the sack exchange. Better than the Sons of Anarchy. Better than Ellis and John Abraham. I think especially what you, the guy we just added from San Francisco, knowing Robert Saleh's scheme, the guys we already had that were great run stuffers, guys that haven't even been turned loose like John Franklin Myers, right? And then you have a healthy Quinnen Williams who was just coming into his own up the middle, and then Carl Lawson. This defensive line is going to be nasty. Nasty.
Yeah, Mike, you are 100%, like 100% right. Like, I had a whole podcast episode where we got into the pass rush. Whole episode was about our pass rush, how we're going to be getting to the quarterback, which is why I'm going to get into Carl Lawson. Then after we talk about Carl Lawson and I get you hyped, man, you're going to freaking love this. The stats on Carl Lawson are amazing. And that's the point. It goes beyond the sacks. Afterward, I got a fun game. And I think the game is going to get you also excited. So starting with Carl Lawson here. So like Keith was saying, sacks are obviously crucial. They're important, but there's more statistics beyond that. Exactly. There's QB knockdowns. There's hitting the QB. There's pressuring the QB just in general. And when we look at all those numbers, Carl Lawson is not just elite. He's one of the best in the NFL. So in 2020 alone, Carl Lawson had 64 QB pressures. That was fourth among all edge rushers. He had 32 QB hits. 32. That's more than Quinnen Williams and John Franklin Myers combined.
Wow.
Combined, he had more. Wow. 32 QB hits. In fact, that was second in the whole NFL, only behind TJ Watt. Now, if you factor that into a single game, because the game is 16 weeks, that means that every single week, Carl Lawson pressured the quarterback four times and hit the quarterback twice.
Wow.
Every single week. That was a minimum of what this man did. Now, when it comes to QB knockdowns, which is almost basically a sack, Carl Lawson had 26 QB knockdowns, tied with TJ Watt for first in the NFL, number one. And when you look at TJ Watt's sack numbers, 15 sacks a season, that's when you realize with Carl Lawson, it's going to translate.
But one of the things that bothers me is his tackle for loss stats. His penetration numbers are ridiculous, but you would think somebody that gets behind the offensive line that much would have more impact with the tackle.
Well, he has the impact.
And he doesn't. So it's like he gets back there, but he doesn't actually execute. You know what I'm saying? Like, he gets the pressure, he gets a, but you know, when it's a running back, whatever, his tackle for loss numbers really don't correlate to the amount of presence that he has back there, because he's getting back there. He's
but don't beaten. Forget.
Oh, Mike, also, I'm going to make you feel a lot better. I got this.
Don't forget, also, he didn't see, I mean, last year was the first time he really started, to be honest. I mean, you looked around most of his career, his first season, he started one game. He was situational. Second year, I think he was hurt, right? Guys, he only played 6 or 7 games. His third year, same thing, situational, got hurt. And then last year, he started 11 games. The whole end of the season, he started, basically.
Yeah.
So this is a guy who started, I think, 14 games. He has 20 sacks in his career. So you take that amount of time he actually plays, right, which was situational for a long time, and last year he got the grind all the time. And it is, if you look at it that way, Mike, through that lens, his numbers are even more impressive.
Yes.
Agreed. Yeah, that's the thing. And again, if you look at just the sack numbers, it's not even impressive. But when you look at 64 QB pressures, when you look at 32 QB hits last year, and then 22 the year before that. So that's 54 QB hits in a 2-year span. Like, wow. This dude has it. And Mike, to make your point, because you know some people have that fear, I have two amazing, perfect examples for you. The first one, Leonard Williams. When Leonard Williams was here, we kept saying that he's a great player, great motor, the ability's there, but the numbers weren't. Well, it translated when he went to the Giants. And another great example is Shaq Barrett. Shaq Barrett, I think, is the perfect example, because when Shaq Barrett was with the Denver Broncos, he wasn't putting up big numbers. He was putting up 1.5 sacks, two sacks.
Yep.
But what's interesting was PFF was rating him as an 81, an 82. How many guys you know with a 1.5 sack that is an edge rusher that gets a rating that high?
You're like, absolutely, that's crazy. Right. And that's why I wanted him. Yep.
Mm-hmm. And then when he had that ability, I wanted him too. Yeah. But because he showed that when he went to Tampa Bay, that ability
exploded.
That's what I'm thinking is going to happen with Carl Lawson. That's my perfect example.
Off the map. Like, it was off the map.
19 and a half sacks. He almost had 20 sacks. Yeah. That's what I'm thinking Carl Lawson's going to happen. That a light's going to go off. So, Rudy, I got a game for you, Mike, and this is going to get you hyped.
Okay.
So, last year, the Jets had 31 sacks. That's it. 31 sacks in the whole freaking year. Mm. Now, based on what I just told you about Carl Lawson, I think you might agree that 10 to 15 sacks isn't impossible for him. Like, that's impossible.
All right.
Now, if we take Quinnen Williams, and let's say John Franklin Myers or Sheldon Rankins. You pick one. The two of them together should be able to get about 15 sacks. That's 7,
yeah.
8 each.
Yeah, right. Cornette 7 last year. That makes sense.
That's 30 right there. So our sack total from last year was just equaled by just three guys. Now we factor in either Sheldon or John Franklin, because whichever one we didn't factor in before, that's probably another 5 to 10, I would say. And then we take everybody else, Foley, Shepard, Huff, that's probably another 10 altogether. That's what I'm saying, bro. We're looking at 50 to 60 sacks, man.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm sure Mosley will sneak a sack in there, one or two. I mean, yeah.
And yeah, we're not even factoring DBs. We're not even factoring other guys getting
exactly.
sacks.
Exactly.
We're not even talking Marcus May yet.
We're potentially
We could be in the 50-60 range.
And we're going to talk about our boy May in a second, guys. We're going to get into that. Marcus May had a couple sacks last year. Basically, the only thing Jamal Adams could do is sack the quarterback. But yeah, I'm excited. Another guy I want to toss to you here. Now, we have a sleeper cell that Harrison's been keeping an eye on here. Oregon State, the highest. I think it was the highest undrafted contract the Jets have ever doled out. Is that correct, Harrison?
For a cornerback. It's actually for a cornerback. Forget the Jets. Not the Jets. It's the highest paid undrafted cornerback in history of the NFL.
Guys, $160,000 guaranteed and $20,000 signing bonus for one Isaiah Dunn from Oregon State. Now, you've been keeping track of him. You know a lot about this kid, Harrison. Why don't you let Jet fans know about him? Because we've been talking about all these different corners. We debated Hall a moment ago. Austin, we got Pinnock. We got Guidry. We have Eccles. We have Lamar Jackson we drafted last year. Ballantyne, Hardy. There's a million guys we have. I don't think many Jet fans know a lot about this kid, Isaiah Dunn.
Yeah, and I didn't either, to be honest. I had, he was an undrafted guy. I was excited about him because he was a wide receiver corner hybrid. And he flashed a lot in high school from what I remember, but in college he didn't do much. But as we heard as of a couple of weeks ago, I think it was last week, I believe, Isaiah Dunn, when Bless Austin was out, was running with the firsts. I thought it was going to be Jason Pinnock, because you guys remember I was telling you how high I was on Pinnock. And he's run a little bit with the firsts, but it's been Isaiah Dunn a lot too. He's running a lot with the firsts. And we mentioned Joe Douglas making him the highest paid undrafted corner ever in the history of the NFL.
Wow.
So that's a statement right there. Now, in college, he struggled. He didn't do a lot at Oregon State. Well, he didn't start his first year. And if you watched Oregon State the last 3 years, they have like 0 wins, 1 win, 2 wins. He could be the product of bad coaching, which could make a lot of sense. Maybe Joe felt that way. Because I went back and looked, and I actually tweeted out today. If you guys want to take a look, check out my Twitter. I checked out his high school footage. And that is legit. This kid shined in high school.
Oh, we need it.
Like, really shined. In fact, his high school coach said he was one of the best man coverage cornerbacks he'd ever coached.
You know what's funny? You said last week when we spoke, Harrison, that it seems like Joe Douglas has a type when it comes to these corners he's going after. And from what I've read, this is another kid who was a track star in high school. So, I mean, he's just going to have dudes flying around out there. There's so many people that's like 10 guys, basically. I mean, they're going to shake out and see what happens. And by the time we start week one, very interested to see what this depth chart looks like.
I'm telling you. And the guy, corner, yes, the undrafted guy I have my eyes on is Hamilcar Richard Jr. That dude, Keith, he's the dude. Remember when we did the undrafted cats? And I was like, son,
2019.
Cat there that got, like, I forgot how many sacks he had. He had like 15 or something wild. I was like, bro, he was like one of the best sack.
I think he had 14 sacks and like 20 sacks? TFLs.
Yeah. And then fell off the map the next year.
Ridiculous. And then COVID.
Well, COVID,
all the things. Sure, and then he went, whatever. But the talent is there.
It was crazy.
As an undrafted guy, but dude, I'll be honest. I like Bryce Huff more. I think Bryce Huff last year was the most amazing undrafted. I couldn't believe he went undrafted. Believe that kid went undrafted.
I love Huff. Oh, yeah. But we got some pieces there. And Salah, I know he's excited. He's excited. We got some
pieces. Mike, with your boy, it's crazy to think that he had that many sacks and then you saw as a criticism, he was just the beneficiary of like things happening or it was lucky or whatever. It's like to have that many sacks at Division I college football, you got to be doing something right. You got to be putting yourself in the right position, right, guys? Like, can't all just be luck and happenstance. Because theoretically, if you did that for 4 years, you'd be breaking sack records out in the Pac-10. So, guys, you know what happened this week also? A little tweet Harrison put out that we chatted about was a comparison going into this season between one safety named Marcus May on the New York Jets and another safety named Jamal Adams on the Seattle Seahawks. Let's get into this. Just let's chop it up about this for a moment because
I do.
From what I saw, it looked like Marcus May, now correct me if I'm wrong, guys, was ranked 7th by PFF going into this year.
You were not wrong.
One Jamal Adams was ranked 10th. Is that correct, guys? Did I see that right? Was there a typo? Did I see something wrong, guys? Because from what I saw, our boy, Marcus May, who had a way better season than Jamal Adams last year, which we'll get into in a second, looks like people are way higher on him. Jamal Adams going into this year, a lot of people are down on him. Coverage skills seem to have completely disappeared. If they were there at all, I don't know. Never a good coverage safety, but last year was one of the worst in the NFL, 49th actually by PFF.
Keith, I don't understand. So I do listen to a few other Jet podcasts just to get information that I may have missed.
Of course.
One of them being Play Like a Jet podcast, Scott Mason. And he was talking about this, Harrison, Keith. And he, you know, they were like, oh, well, does Jamal Adams deserve to get paid more than Marcus May? And Scott Mason was like, he poo-pooed it completely. He was like, everyone knows Jamal Adams is a better safety. I don't know why anyone would think that he's not. Yeah, he may not have the best ball coverage skills, but he gets to the quarterback. And he essentially was just like, Jamal Adams is a better safety. No, Scott, he's not. What he's are not. You talking about?
He's not.
Like you can look at every metric, okay? PFF. Statistics, game impact. Last season, Jamal Adams was not a better NFL safety than Marcus May, period. Now, if you want to take the full context of Jamal Adams and like his bravado and his history and everything like that and his brand and make that why someone should pay someone services, then that's your view, but that's not how the NFL looks at players. It says, what can you do for me? And from last season, Marcus May did more for the New York Jets on field than Jamal Adams did playing safety. Yes, he had sacks. Yes, he got to the quarterback. What else did he do? I see. So I hear these guys sometimes, Harrison and Keith, and I'm listening, like, what planet? Do they understand football? Like, what is he talking about? I can't, man.
When you think about it, it's actually beautiful. Like, it's amazing. Like, again, it's just the brilliance of Joe Douglas. Like, he traded away Jamal Adams at a time when we thought he was trading away the better safety. Everyone unanimously was saying he's trading away the better safety. That was easily, even there wasn't anyone who would say otherwise. Yeah. And Joe Douglas gets two first round picks and a third round pick. And a player. When we look at guys like Julio Jones, who's a freaking Hall of Fame wide receiver, who is literally one of the greatest wide receivers of all time. Yo, check this out, great Joe Douglas is. Joe Douglas got more for one of the worst quarterbacks statistically in the NFL than the Falcons got for one of the greatest wide receivers of all time. Like, Joe Douglas straight up mugs people. Like, he's got a gun to their back. He's like, give me your money. Like, he's taking their wallet. He's taking everything.
Yeah, and guys, like last year, like Mike said, when you get into the stats, and Jamal Adams missed four games, but the biggest ability in sports is availability. You got to be out there to make the plays, right, guys? Especially when you want to get that fat contract extension. Can't just play 12 games. Ain't going to happen. But our boy had, Marcus May had more tackles than Jamal Adams did, had 11 passes defended. Jamal Adams only had three. I know Jamal Adams had the sacks, but Marcus May had two interceptions, two big interceptions, two forced fumbles. PFF grade was 82.9. Jamal Adams coming in around a 64? Trash bag level. His coverage grade, one of the worst in the league. Now, this other thing I want to get into, which I find the best part. Harrison said this is wonderful, and I love this as well, guys. This year, it's 2021. Jamal Adams is on the last year of his rookie contract. Now, why did he leave the Jets again? Did you guys remind me? I forget what it was.
Exactly. That's the beauty of it, man.
I love it.
He wanted that long-term deal, right? Like, he was going to get that long-term money. And I remember last year when the Jets approached him, they said, look, you guys remember, they said that Landon Collins kind of contract, maybe 6 years, $88 million, you get 45 guaranteed, you get 14, $15 million average, blah, blah, blah. That's what leaked out as the Jets' intentions, at least. Jamal Adams said, no, I want to be the highest paid player in the league. You gave Mosley $17 million, I want to make $18 million. Okay, we know how that went. We don't have to go through that all again. But I do know this, that if he would have signed that contract with the Jets, what we offered, he would have made $14 million last year. He'd be making $14 million this year. Last year with Seattle, he made $4 million. This year, he's making $9 million. He's already cost himself $13 million. Okay? Not only did you cost yourself $13 million, now you're a diminishing asset. Because, yeah, you got sacks, but you couldn't cover anybody last year. So I get that some safeties have strengths. Some guys are good around the line of scrimmage. Jamal Adams is one of those guys. Some guys are tremendous in coverage. Reed, a ton of guys like that are coverage guys, right? But you're not someone that's going to get the money you want when you're one-dimensional. You know Troy Polamalu, Adams. You were shying away from a tackle last year. We put you on blast on the show. We all saw it.
It's offensive line. Henry gets caught in the mix. And Jamal Adams, at the end of that play, yeah, he didn't really stick his head in there the way you would expect. And
we all saw what happened. Not only did he cost himself the money, then Marcus May goes, outplays him last year. He gets
franchised. That's why I want him to get paid so bad. I want May to get paid so we can just be like,
oh! And even this year, just this year, Marcus May gets franchised. He's making 10.6. Jamal Adams is making 9.8. I just everything about it.
No, it's amazing. It's incredible. We talked about this on the phone. It's crazy. He left specifically because he wanted to get paid. That was the thing. And his players cost him that. And if you think about it,
I think he just wanted to be off the Jets because they were losing. That's what I think it was.
I agree. I think it's both.
Probably a combination of both. Because it seemed like when he got drafted, if you guys remember when Jamal Adams got drafted, his comments were, "I'm never going to be a problem. I'm here." And all these years, he's ride or die with the Jets. We're going to figure it out. I think the losing got to him, Mike. And then I think the money is how he, in his head, reasoned the Jets could make it okay. You guys lose all the time, but you'll make it okay to me if you just pay me $18 million. Because he thought he's that good. You know, he thinks in his head, his ego's that big, I deserve to be one of the highest paid players in the league. And as long as you keep me paid that level, I'll stay on this bum ass team I don't want to be on.
And that's kind of what I was trying to say, you know, before. Like, we all know that, and you and me, Keith, we talked all about why I really don't like Jamal Adams. Like, yeah. I was fine in that situation. It was what he did later on that really, really upset me.
He's a me guy. Yeah. He's a me guy.
It's more than that. But
yeah, he's just, and the way he exited out, I know it didn't bother you. Had other issues you took umbrage with Harrison, but I just, you know, it's a manifestation of like the modern times that we live in, that when you don't get what you want, now athletes just pout, force their way out, bury the team, bury the people that supported you and drafted you and have had your back the whole time. And they have no problem doing it. And Jamal Adams, my whole point is he presented himself as a completely different version of that. He's a completely different person. I'm not that guy. And they ended up being a complete fraud. But guess what, guys? We got plenty of picks. We have the better safety. We have another first round pick next year. Oh, Jamal Adams,
Jeff Van should be excited. Keith, you're excited. I'm excited. Be excited. Why not? Yeah. When the hell else are we excited, right? Yeah. So it's time, man. Enjoy it. Eat it.
Yeah, and when we went ahead and you saw Elijah Vera Tucker get drafted to the Jets, I mean, theoretically, he might be even better than Becton. Guys, we can thank you, Jamal Adams, for that. Yeah. Joe Douglas, of course.
Exactly. No, yeah, I said the same thing. Yeah, exactly. That was thanks to the Jamal Adams trade. Yeah. But what I was saying before was just quick. Jamal wants to be paid. That's the thing. And he thinks his value is so much more than it is. So I'm just like trying to imagine a scenario where Seattle, because he's been so bad, doesn't want to pay him and he wants this big deal. Could you imagine if he walked? Like, that means basically they gave us those two first rounders for a 2-year loaner. Yeah, of Jamal Adams.
That's the other angle on this, Harrison. You hit the nail on the head. Goodness. Is that the pressure, the position they put themselves in, Seattle? It's like you go out, you spend 100 G's on a car, you drive down the road, and you're like, oh my God, I bought a lemon. Like, you can't tell anyone. You're so embarrassed. You're like, I have to fix this car. I can't tell anyone I just wasted this money. They have to figure it out with him. You know, they really put themselves in a tough spot because they gave up the amount they gave up. I mean, good quarterbacks are getting traded for less. You mentioned Julio Jones got traded for less.
Exactly.
I mean, tremendous players in the NFL have been traded for less than Jamal Adams. Don't get me wrong. When we traded him, his value was very high and he was a good safety. I'm not saying Jamal Adams is a bad player or anything like that. I'm just saying, like you said, where he thinks his value's at and where it is in 2021, I don't think those things are matching up in real time. And how we know that's a fact, still doesn't have that contract.
Doesn't. Yeah, but Mike, shout out to your boy before that was saying Jamal's so much better. You have to evaluate each position accordingly to how they play. First of all, safety is not a value position anymore. We have to accept that. It's all about having an elite corner that can shut somebody down. Safety, yeah, no, even the most highest paid safeties don't make bank.
He wasn't saying that he's so much better. He was just saying that he's going to get the bigger contract because he's the better safety. And he was saying it in a way. Better. He was saying it in a way that was just dismissive. Like, oh no, Jamal, I don't agree. Jamal Adams is a better safety. Yeah, he may not be as good in coverage, but his value is better.
But
no,
coverage is the name of the game, and that's the point.
Scott,
no, the
Scott, he's not. Exactly. Now, I agree with Scott and what he said, what May's value, because if May's asking for $20 million, I agree. Scott's saying, you know, pay him 13, 14, somewhere in that range, which agreed, you know, 10, 12, 13, 14, around there, you want to do that, that's fine. But if he's asking for upwards of $15 million, I'm not paying May that much.
Well, I actually had a whole podcast on the May situation. I think it's unique and different than the way people are looking at it. We know Marcus May's value. I mean, PFF ranked him higher than Jamal Adams. He's the 7th ranked safety in the NFL. Again, superior coverage skills, proved he can play in the box, and he does everything. He did everything Jamal Adams does, plus he can cover. So I think Joe Douglas, he's proven it with other guys. He knows value. He understands what May's value is for. My take is it's not the money. It's the duration.
It's the duration.
Because May's 28 years old. So I'm thinking May wants like a 4-year deal. And Joe's like, hey, you know, I want to give you a 2 to maybe 3. I think that's where the hang up is. I think it's less the money.
I feel like all the big contracts now are all 3 years, unless you're Patrick Mahomes and you sign for 100 years. You know, it's 3 years and that's it. You know, and then guaranteed at least. Like those are the longest contracts out, so give him a 3-year deal.
That's what I would do. I'd give him more guarantee. That's the trick. More guaranteed.
Yeah,
and Mike, I give him 2 years. Yeah, more guaranteed.
When your boy discounts, you know, May and Adams in the comparison, and says, "Oh, he doesn't cover here as good," but like, I mean, that's 50% of the game. More than that, when you're a safety, when you're discounting your coverage skills as a safety,
that's what I was saying before. Like, that position matters. Yeah,
yeah, it doesn't make any. I mean, that argument doesn't make a lot of sense to me. I mean, the reason that Jamal Adams can blitz effectively is because when you have a safety out there, you're assuming he's going to cover someone. Then when they don't, they surprise you, they get a sack maybe, right? Like if he's like, oh, I'm just gonna line up as, I'm so good at sacking dudes, I'm gonna line up as an outside linebacker. Bro, you're 210. That wouldn't work. So his effectiveness, it's like, when his only skill is rushing the quarterback around the line of scrimmage, you're leaving a hole for your team in the second.
Yeah, but May can do that.
Adams can.
I agree.
When it comes to Adams, they had the worst secondary imaginable last year, the Seahawks. They got him for that reason. They were last in the league, almost last in the league when it comes to passes against. So they were, they actually got worse with Jamal Adams in their secondary last
year. It's lazy analysis. And what I've learned the more I've gotten into this podcasting game, guys, is that there are podcasters, there are analysts who just stick with the narrative. And then there are those who actually make a opinion off of educated knowledge and go and step out there with, you know, if you go on Bleacher Report right now, the guy who ranked position help had the Jets as ranked 30th last year. Guess what? They have them ranked 30th this year. Laziness, dumbness, stupidness. They have no, they're just, we're the Jets. So we're the 30th ranked.
Oh, okay. I can't wait to
if they didn't actually look at what it's ridiculous.
It's ridiculous.
And it's not being a fanboy. Yeah. This team is not the 30th ranked offense in the league. No. It's not. I understand there's questions about Zach Wilson. He's a rookie. I understand LaFleur. There's questions there. But you look across the board with what we've added. Yeah. Again, lazy analysis because they're the Jets. And until the Jets do something, they're going to be lazy. Or people look at, you know, the great teams like Tampa Bay. They brought everybody back. Everyone assumes they're just going to go and stomp everyone out. Guess what? Tom Brady, 45 years old. He's not going to do it forever. So you can go and get on that bandwagon and go ride them off to another Super Bowl. He's 45. He's going to fall off one day. Y'all saw what happened to Peyton
Manning. I'm waiting for it, bro. I've been waiting for five freaking years.
Peyton Manning. Peyton Manning's, the ball just started fluttering. Like, I don't know what happened. He just fell off. We were all like, what the hell's wrong with Peyton?
Yeah.
Got old.
Didn't Tom Brady have like 40-something touchdowns last year? Like, I don't want to give that man any credit. I've been waiting for like almost a decade for his ass to slow down, I feel like.
What is up with
him? I don't get what's going on with him. They got to check him for the human growth hormone or something. I don't know what's going on there.
Agreed.
That dude is like, something's up. Either that or he's like part Olympian or something.
I don't know.
I don't know. He's from Wakanda. I don't know. Something crazy. I don't know.
He just keeps playing forever. I mean, we've been waiting for him to fall off. And I mean, Brady's eventual decline will come, but it's just not coming anytime soon. I don't think, guys. With the way they've surrounded him there with the Buccaneers, receivers, and he never gets hit. And if you do hit him, you get a flag on you. So Tom Brady's got a nice little posh setup there. I think he's going to be doing good. But we don't care about that no more, guys. Guess what? Because he's down in Tampa Bay. He's not there in New England torturing us. Right. New England's going to have Cam Newton out there. They're going to have Matt.
I still hate him, though.
Oh, I hate him. You can never not hate him. But I think my hate was a little lessened once he left the Patriots. You know, the evil empire.
I hate New England, and that's it.
Oh, you hate
him. Tom Brady. I dislike him, but New England. I want that.
I actually realized I hate Brady more than New England. I realized you do? That when he left. I do. I do. I realized that when he left.
Yeah, I hate that.
I'm not gonna step on your. I have a lot of pent-up feelings. And the reason why, you know what it
is? Here's the
thing. Can I just explain something real quick? Okay. Chipper Jones, I'm a Met fan. Chipper Jones kicked our ass always, but I never hated him. I respected him when he retired because
that's kind of what I was going to say.
He did it the right way. You know what I'm saying?
And named his daughter Shay.
During the steroid era, he was kicking our ass and he didn't do cheating or nothing. And I give it, when he retired, I said, Chipper, hats off, you killed my soul, but I respect you. When I found out what the Patriots were doing, after all the things, you know, they're beating our ass, but I wasn't like, I didn't have the hatred. And then I found out the cheating also. It just went inside. So I'm like, I can't explain it. And I just look at that team like, yo, you know what? Y'all over there?
Well, to be fair, you could throw Belichick into the equation too. That I hate them both. It's them. Because this is the way I looked at it. Like, I thought about it. I was like, okay, when I was a kid and Drew Bledsoe was the quarterback of the Patriots, I didn't hate the Patriots. Me like, either. I didn't. And that's how I'm looking at it. So I realized, okay, maybe you agree with me that it's Brady and Belichick. Like, that's where the hate – because, like, I didn't hate them. I'm with you. That's what I'm saying. Like, the cheating – but with Brady, the cheating, the deflating of the footballs, the arrogant attitude, the cursing. There's so much.
You go into the hotel, they're pulling fire alarms at 2 in the morning, waking up the team.
How come when he threw the freaking Super Bowl trophy, the Lombardi, the trophy that means something, when he threw it from boat to boat like it was a joke, why did they praise him? I was actually kind of pissed. You're treating it like it's a freaking beach ball.
Yeah, I mean, there's other players in the league, and we don't have to go down this road, that could have done the same thing. Probably would have been treated with a different approach by the media, Harrison. I thought it's funny you say that.
And that's another thing with Brady. I feel like how many times we know this is not even – we thought it was with New England. It's Brady and Tampa Bay too. There are quarterbacks. Cam Brady, you can murder him, and you won't get a flag. You can literally break him in half, and you won't get a flag. Tom Brady, all you have to do is breathe on his neck. Yeah. That's all you have to do. Just come behind him and breathe on his neck, and it's a penalty.
All right, Harrison, I know you got all types of stuff going on social media. Want to let people know where they can find you?
Definitely, man. I'd love for you guys to check me out. So I actually have my own company. We do Jets writing, Jets reporting. I was having issues with my website. I do it all myself. It's my company. I had a bunch of issues with my website. It's been a couple of months. I'm still working them out a little bit, but I wrote an article today on the Keelan Cole situation.
Saw that,
to get right because I wasn't able to write for a while because we could do a whole episode on that. I feel like I've learned.
I saw your post. I was letting everyone know because it's been a thing.
You should know it's all me. Like, I do it myself. Yeah. But I own my own company. We're a legit business registered to the state. We're Take Flight Media. I have Jets writing, Jets reporting. The website is takeflightmedia.org. You could find me on Twitter at NYJets, TF Media. But like you see on the name of me right here on, I think it's on this side, right here on I forgot where we are for a second. Zoom. Right here on Zoom. I was like, where are we? Right here on Zoom. I have the Take Flight Spit and Fire podcast I do every Monday. It's Monday nights live on YouTube at 7 p.m. I have guests sometimes. I've had Matt O'Leary. I've had Richie Malora. Have a lot of great guys on. But I do a lot of my own myself as well. Again, Monday nights, the Take Flight Spit and Fire podcast. Check it out.
Anyone doesn't want to get at us, support us, involve themselves in the Ain't Easy Being Green world in any way, shape, or form. Mike, where could they do that?
Hey, guys, please go to YouTube, search AEBG. We're on YouTube. We're looking to just, you know, take it to the next level. Got getting subscribers, you know, getting action. We're going to deliver an amazing product to you. So please subscribe, like our shows. We're on Facebook. We're on Instagram. We're on Twitter. We are everywhere, hosted on SoundCloud. So please give us a like and a listen. And we appreciate the love, baby. Go Jets.
All right. On behalf of the biggest Jet fan in the state of Texas, Michael Agaris, and the busiest man in the Jet world today, Harrison Glazer, my name is Keith Farrell. Good at you next week, everybody. Peace out.